Hello, I'm Chris Flisher, and welcome to Turning of the Wheel, an intelligent, lively discussion on astrology, art, and adventure. Timing is everything, and as the great wheel turns, we are best prepared when we are best informed. Join me as I explore the current planetary alignments and offer insights for coping with change. Educational, informative, enlightening, the Turning of the Wheel is a welcome pause in your daily swirl of constant change. Through intelligent discourse, inspired guests, and educational segments, I will help to enlighten your knowledge of astrology and guide you to accept change as the great wheel of life turns. Call in with your questions and speak with some of the greatest visionaries in the time-tested practice of astrology. Turning of the Wheel, Astrology, Art, and Adventure with Chris Flisher, each week on Turning of the Wheel podcast. Hello and welcome to Turning of the Wheel. My name is Chris Flisher. You know this show is about astrology, and it's one of my favorite topics. I spend a lot of time doing that. I'm also an artist as well as a podcast host, but I spend most of my time delving into astrology. An interesting topic today that deals with the Sabian symbols. I've got a guest coming on in a few minutes. Before we get started, I want to remind you about my newsletter, which goes out every Sunday afternoon. In there, you'll find a couple of paragraphs of mundane astrology, and then I break it out into the individual signs beyond that. And then you will see I also have links to my podcast and to my television education series, which are all about astrology and available to all for free, by the way. So if you feel so inclined and you would feel as if I've done a good job in my work there, then perhaps throw me a tip in the old tip jar or donate to help keep the great wheel turning. All contributions are very, very welcome. My website is chrisflisher.com. turningofthewheel.com. I'm on Facebook as Chris Flisher. I'm on Twitter as Chris Flisher, and I think that covers what I'm on that I can recall. Maybe somewhere else, but that's the best I can do. I've also got turningofthewheel.tv, excuse me, which is a forum for my video lectures and brief descriptions of the signs. There's a half-hour segments there, excuse me, that goes through all of the individual signs, the planets and the houses, and a number of other important astrology aspects, as well as a number of interesting, very interesting guests I've had on over the years. So I encourage you to go there, turningofthewheel.tv. So without further ado, let's get started on the subject. Years ago, in my search, I came across the Sabian Assembly and the work of Marc Edmund Jones, who was a very well-known astrologer back in the early 1900s, and from a remarkable story. I've had many shows on in the past about the Sabian Assembly and the Sabian symbols, and for people who are interested in them, they're really quite profound in their accuracy and in their sort of prophetic kind of ability to glance into the time and see where we are. They really are quite incredible. The story is one I'll let my guest fill you in on when he comes on, and his name is Mo Saladin. And the website is sabianearth.wordpress.com. That's S-A-B-I-A-N, earth.wordpress.com. And you'll see what they've been doing there. He's going to enlighten us as to what he's done with regard to the work of Edmund Jones and everything else. So, Mo, welcome to the show today. It's great to have you on.
Thank you, Chris. I'm glad to be here. And we'll see what we can do with this information.
Yeah, so let's just get started. Let's give at least a brief, you know, elevator speech, a talk about what the Sabian symbols are and Marc Edmund Jones, just so people get an overview and can sort of get some context for it.
Right. Well, at Sabian Earth, we went to the back of the book where there are 1,000 charts.
Which book is this? Which book is this?
This is Sabian Symbols in Astrology, published in 1953. By Marc Edmund Jones.
Now, let's just fill, before we get started, I want to fill in people so they know who Marc Edmund Jones was and how the whole Sabian symbols came to be.
Well, he was an astrologer early on, and he did a series of books. There's like 8 astrology books, Mundane Astrology, Scope, Hori. There's a guide to, you know, the temperament types. There's a series of books that are available, and if you contact us at Sabian Earth, we can get those books to you, okay. All right, through somebody that has the books, which I have talked to you about that before.
Right. So I want to set the stage a little bit if I could. Yeah. Marc Edmund Jones was a renowned astrologer. He was also a Presbyterian minister and a screenwriter for Hollywood. And he was on the West Coast. And he had the opportunity to meet a woman named Elsie Wheeler, who was crippled by rheumatoid arthritis. And the two of them got together, put their heads together, and decided to come up with this idea for an oracle. And They went to a park in San Diego called Balboa Park, and Marc Edmund Jones had devised, drawn up a series of cards, one for each symbol and each sign and each degree of the entire zodiac wheel. So there'd be, you know, 4 degrees Leo, 6 degrees Gemini, 18 degrees Sagittarius, and so forth. He had all the signs, all the degrees in these stacks of cards, and he had them all shuffled up and mixed. Then, over the course of the day, when they did this, he handed a blank card to Elsie Wither. She did not know what was on the other side. She did not know the degree that was being mentioned. And he handed her the card, and she would come up with sort of an oracle or a vision of what she saw on that card. And that's what formed the basis for the Sabine symbols. Now, if you go to any book about the Sabine symbols, you will see this all there. And you'll see each degree has an image that's associated with it that allows the person to use it as an oracle or as a prophetic tool. And it's remarkably accurate. What you do is you find your birthday, you find the degree of your sun, and you go to the next degree up. So in my case, my sun is 12 degrees, 5 minutes of Aries. So I would look at 13 degrees Aries, and that would be my sort of Sabian oracle. And you can do it for any point on the whole chart. So I think that's a fascinating way to set the stage with regard to how we look at this whole process. So go ahead, Mom. Sorry to interrupt. I just want to get that clear.
No, that's good. So that's one of the aspects that Marc followed to put the book together. And, of course, there are symbols that go back. Many different people have done symbols, and many different people have done symbols going forward. So it's been a task that astrologers have felt to take on by themselves individually or otherwise, because of their understanding of each degree or the signs themselves. And that's how these images, these different images across, you know, two centuries, basically back to the 1800s, you know, came to be. But one of the other things that he was trying to do was to list charts that he had looked at and had advised on. And he put them in an appendix in the back of the book. Mm-hmm. So our task was to look at these charts and do rectifications, essentially. And the other thing is that in doing a rectification, you can use the Sabian symbols. You could do a logical basis for a rectification with people's main individual things that happen to them in their lifetime. So a marriage, okay, or an appointment to a very specific job, or say a movie that was a big hit. So you could track those, and then you could use the natal to figure out a rectification. So we do rectifications. Anybody that wants a rectification, just go to sabianearth.com, and mm-hmm. we can do that for you.
So a rectified chart is one where all the data is not complete. There may be something that's missing. Perhaps the birth time is missing or other pieces of information. As we look back over history, astrology was not always as accurate as it is today because people didn't always record the birth time. And the birth time, as you know, is very critical to the understanding of the chart and the orientation of the houses and everything else. So without some pieces of information, it's difficult to put together that. Rectification allows us to look back at famous people's lives and determine events in their lives that would then match up, and then you are able to sort of back into the chart and become more accurate. Is that correct? Is that how I... Yeah, okay, very good.
That's how you do it. So that's one of the things. And so we had this list of 1,000 charts in the back of the book. And so as we went through, I mean, we found a lot of, like, errors. Not because the people who were helping Marc to do the charts, it's just that their informational basis was limited. And there would be days, you know, there'd be years that were different. Okay, I mean, I think I was looking at a chart the other day, I think there was a 7-year difference by what he listed and what we found in doing like a deeper dive into research.
7 years is a significant amount of time because within that 7 years, there would be a significant square or opposition or a alignment of Saturn in that case.
Yeah, so people have to realize. And then some of the sites that are available to us that do a lot of charts, they're looking for a piece of paper with a date and a place and hopefully a time. Mm-hmm. All right. It could be a birth certificate. It could be in a Bible. Yeah, families kept these records. So that's what's called, like, on the astro.com site, it's called an A rating.
Right.
So she rates them A, B, C. You know, as you go down the C, you're getting dirty information.
Right. So let me just clarify that. Let me clarify that for a minute for the folks listening. On Astro Databank, astro.com, there's called the Astro Databank. And what they do is they have listings of people's, you know, thousands and thousands and thousands of people who were there. But in many cases, the recorded information there is not accurate. And the accuracy is judged by the grade that's given. So an A grading or a double or a triple rating by Rodden. It's the Rodden system. Lois Rodden is the one who devises. We know that that's accurate. In other words, if a person has a birth certificate and it's validated as the time that was born, it's validated a number of ways, it gets a triple A rating. Then it goes down to double A, B, C, D. So as you get down to the lower numbers, you know, the C's and the D's, the accuracy is very dirty, as you say. So that's why rectification becomes a necessity.
Right, and we've rectified a lot of charts, even because they don't do rectification.
Right.
Okay, that's why it doesn't do it. So that was one of the other areas. Now, Susan Lussos, who I work with, who does an unbelievable job, okay, in terms of her ability to utilize the technology. And I'm just like there for communication back and forth when she finally gets through all the data, that then we talk about it, and then we're able to come up with information that fits basically both from a very logical point of view and a database view, and then from an intuitive based view. Mm-hmm. And that's what we do, because you can use the symbols.
Right.
So a chart, you know, we could have a time, all right, and the time is recorded, and it's a good time, but it could vary by 5 or 10 minutes.
Right.
All right.
And in that 5 or 10 minutes, you've got a whole new structure of the housing system that changes.
Right.
The,
then you've got
ascendant.
4 minutes moves a degree, right, on the circle. Mm-hmm. So that's why we decided to do this work.
Right.
And we not only did his charts, we did a lot of people that would come up. So, you know, Sue would be working on charts, and then something would come up, and it would be a person in the news or something like that. And then we'd say, okay, let's do this chart. All right. And that's what we would do. So it's not just the charts from, you know, Marc, it's a lot of other charts that we found people who are interesting, and that's how we put together our database. Sure.
Yeah, and the importance of the accuracy of the chart. I mean, anybody who's listened to this show over the years know how I always speak about the accuracy of the chart and how important it is for the birth time. Because of over the course of history, you know, people were in 100, 200 years ago may have been born on a farm on a snowy night in the middle of January when no one was around, and they just assumed that it was around this time. No one knows. That's the sort of thing that this process is trying to clarify. And these are people who are well known, who maybe come through, you know, centuries ago, famous authors, famous, you know, composers or whatever they may be, generals, whatever they may be, whose birth accuracy may not have been as crisp as we'd like to see. So by rectifying them, we are able to get into a more accurate, interesting, more detailed chart as a result of knowing them. And that can only occur through rectification. Rectification occurs by tying significant events in that person's life to aspects in the chart, and then you sort of back your way up to what it looks like to be the normal house structure.
Yeah, so we were working today and yesterday. We were working with Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
Interesting. Okay.
We had a chart. Okay. We had decided on a chart many months ago. Mm-hmm. All right. We pulled it back up. Reason being is about 2 weeks ago, which is kind of by coincidence, she happened to come to Buffalo, New York, which is where I'm living, and I have my clinic. And I'm working downstairs in my clinic, and all of a sudden, like everybody, it's like around 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and I knew she was in town, but I live 500 feet from Symphony Hall, which is obviously a bit, you know, fits 2,000 people.
Right.
And so I'm seeing all these things. I said, what the heck's going? And then all of a sudden I realized she was 500 feet from my door. Right.
Wow. Yeah.
And I'm, you know, so I'm saying, like, you know, this is kind of like serendipity here, right?
Synchronicity, if nothing else. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Right. So then we started to look at the chart again, and they say, well, why is she going around? Because she came to Buffalo and she had just finished the radiation treatment.
Right. Right. All right? Yeah. I remember that. Like, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
It was like 2 or 3 days. So we pulled the chart and we re-rectified it, and you know. I mean, I'm an acupuncturist by trade. Mm-hmm. So I see a lot of people in the health field, and I've come across different things. And she basically didn't look healthy to me from my point of view.
Right.
Because Eastern, it's a whole different way of looking at the body. Much more
you can tell by the pallor of their skin, the color of their tongue.
They're asking, looking, listening, you know, yeah. How they hold themselves.
Right, their demeanor.
But I mean, it was a far view because it was on TV and you know, pictures in the local newspaper and stuff like mm-hmm. that.
Well, she is in her 90s, so she's in her 90s, right?
Yeah, I'm going to say from what I could say, but I, you know, I can't say it specifically, but she is very sick.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I kind of look at this tour as like, it's like Derek Jeter going around his last year.
Yeah.
And she, you know, like 2 days ago or 3 days ago, she was at Georgetown, you know, talking
to the first class. Making the rounds kind of, so to speak.
Yeah, she's making the rounds, and it's kind of unusual for, I'm saying like, wouldn't you want to recover from your health a little bit? Because we look at it a little bit differently.
Right.
I mean, you basically, you take your time and you rest and you come back slowly. So I would say if she doesn't have stage 4 cancer, I don't know what she has.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just telling people who are big supporters of her and everything like that, don't be surprised.
Get ready. Yeah, okay? Exactly. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Get ready. And the other thing is I can give a personal story. One of my close friends who ran a health food store for many, many, many years. And towards the end, it wasn't towards the end because I didn't know. I was treating her for different things. And then I told her daughter, I says, she's got to go to the hospital. I don't know what's wrong, but something's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And she went to the hospital, and it was stage 4 cancer, and she died in 9 days.
Wow.
So,
and she showed no outward signs?
Nothing. No outward signs. I'm telling you. It was like you're doing, you know, like she's doing, like she's going around and everything like that. She's showing no outward signs. And it's almost like it could happen immediately.
Right.
It's like, boom. It's like, this is it.
Right.
It's kind of a very interesting health situation for a physical body.
Right. Exactly.
That's all I'm
saying. I mean, you know, and we all have limits. Our mileage may vary, as I always say, and we don't know what kind of we're going to get out of it. And so, and she knows how important a character is. She is. But this, and when you looked at her chart, what was it about her chart that allowed you to come to that conclusion? Was this just based on your own personal observation?
Well, the two things is, I like all of us, she doesn't, the two things that we came up with, one, she's very fearful of death. Not from a psychological point of view, but she doesn't want her legacy to be taken down by Trump.
Right. And she doesn't want to be replaced by somebody who's a conservative.
No. Right. Yeah, exactly.
So she's hanging on for the sake of the country in many ways.
Yeah, that's what she feels. But in terms of her own personal thing, it's this thing about, I don't want my legacy to be taken over by this man.
Right. Yeah, I understand.
And that's basically what. And if she does, you know, face the ultimate. We all face the ultimate. Like, we don't get out of here alive.
Right. No one does.
Right. No one gets out alive, ladies and gentlemen. Are you out there?
It's true.
It's true. So, I mean, it's not trying to be morbid about it.
Of course not.
All right?
Of course not. It's reality.
This is not a morbid. It's just like in astrology, one of the things you want to realize is you have preferences, all right? And you're directed down certain ways. But you also, if you get into these situations, you can make adjustments.
Yes, and
I mean,
you can
it
make
could.
adjustments according to the timing of what's going on with your chart based on where you are in your chart at that time and place. So you, when
Exactly.
you, so along with the rectification process that you guys are doing, you're finding you're finding new information out about individuals to the point where I'm sure people who are born on the cusp, if their birth information were more accurate, might even put them in a different sign. Is that correct?
Exactly. That would do. The other thing is what's interesting. We have a lot of people that go to savingearth.com and they don't even know astrology because we do write-ups on these people. We've got, and Jones has these interesting characters because they go back into the 1840s and 30s because he was born, what, in 1888? So, I mean, that's his time frame, and he lived for 90 years. All right. So most of the people that he was putting in there were people he might have liked, you know, he might have advised them. They might have been clients of his or whatever. And so this is how this came about. And if you just go in and you're not an astrologer and read some of the biographical information, you'd be amazed how interesting and like very famous these people were, but you wouldn't know who they were.
Because
I mean, you know,
they were
somebody
sort
born
of
in the
locked they,
1840s.
they're sort of locked in
Yeah.
a place in time where they may not have been.
Yes.
And this is the interesting thing about astrology. I think you and I had this conversation the other day,
Yeah.
was that over the course of history, there may be many people who were philanthropists or do-gooders or did made, but they never made the headlines. They never made it up through the point where you're an Abraham Lincoln or you're a Toscanini or, someone like that. You doesn't get that far. So, but that doesn't mean that
Yeah.
there isn't the validity in the chart. A person could be a wonderful mayor of a small town or something like that, but we wouldn't know who the mayor of Illinois of Chicago was in 1850. We could find that out, but he's not a memorable on the greater panoply
Right.
of American history. So as a result of that, we don't get the same impact. But when you look at the charts of these people who are lesser known and you see the accuracy of the chart and what they ended up being, there's a instant proof of that of the astrology and how well it is works when it is done handled properly, interpreted properly.
Right. We were doing the other day, because I'm doing the filing. We have 435 natal charts. All right. And we have almost the same amount of mundane charts.
Okay, mundane
We would
charts
do a
as
week.
it mundane charts apply to all of us, right?
All of us, right. And we might do like the autumn equinox. When the election appeared in 2016, we did the fall equinox chart, and that gave us that Trump was going to win. All
And
right.
what was the distinguishing characteristic of that chart that made you think that?
So one of the things that there was the bald-headed man. So we'll just take that as we took it as Obama. Okay. And the reason we took it as Obama is because there have been times in the history of the United States. All right. This goes back to Nixon with Eisenhower. Eisenhower didn't campaign for him. Okay. Same thing with Ronald Reagan and George H.W. Bush. Okay. Same thing with Clinton and Gore, who lost. So there's people who have lost. They were vice presidents and then they didn't win. All right. And so Hillary Clinton wasn't vice president, but she was Secretary of State. I mean, she was a heavy duty, you know, she was an accomplished person in, but he didn't really campaign as hard. We're saying, you know, he's kind of backing away from this whole like campaign. All right. He showed up a couple of places, but not in the places where it would have made a difference.
Right, so he didn't throw his weight behind her.
He did not throw his weight behind her. And we said, we were seeing this and we say, this doesn't make sense. But that's one of the things I remember. I haven't looked at the chart since that time, but that was one of the things that popped out at us. And so, you know, Susan did a great job on that. And we discussed it. And of course, Hillary beat Trump by what, 3 million votes?
Popular vote,
Popular vote, 3 million votes. And that would have been if you're going to win, if you're going to lose by 3 million votes, you should be able to win the election.
Of course you should. This is the problem with the Electoral College.
Absolutely. I mean, you got so many votes, but it came in these really, you know, small,
Concentrated pockets around the country, like the all of California,
pockets on the coast.
Yeah, a lot of the East Coast.
Yes,
yeah.
And I think the other thing we saw was that her campaign manager and the people who were advising her were off base.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there were a lot of things that misled that. But the value of astrology in this case, were you able to rectify Hillary's chart? Did her chart require rectification? I don't think that she's got a very high rating with regard to her birth time.
We got a chart up on the site. Yeah, mm-hmm. We did a rectification.
Okay, and because I know that she had, I know she's a Scorpio, but I think there was some question as to her rising sign, or sun.
Yes, that was the big thing, and it was. Like where she was born too.
Mm-hmm.
There were like two different hospitals or something, as I remember.
So the value of rectifying the chart allows you to take the data of the accomplishments of her life, tie it to significant events, and then back up to a point where you find out where the chart actually might be. So what did you conclude with her with regard to Hillary Clinton?
Well, what we concluded was that she was facing a situation that before she was able to utilize her intelligence and her ability to break through. I mean, on the world stage, she was able to walk in and visit presidents all over the world, right?
Right, yeah.
And, I mean, she visited Putin, I think, two or three times.
Yeah, they didn't have a very good relationship, I know that.
No, they didn't have at all. And that seemed to not work. It wasn't, you know, somehow that part of her ability was blunted in the debates with DT.
Mm-hmm.
And the
symbol that sort of ticked you off to that was what? Was the symbol of her sun sign, or was it the symbol of her sun?
No, it was in the fall equinox chart. And was up on the midheaven. That was the one that I told you, the bald-headed man.
Okay.
That was the key. For some reason, we locked in on that. So people got to realize that in a chart, there are so many avenues that you can go down.
Right.
And, okay, I'm going to follow this path. It's like science in a way. It's a logical thing. People want all this airy-fairy stuff about it, right? But it's not just that. It has a specific way of understanding it from a very logical point of view. And you can't just dismiss that.
Right.
I'm going to use just my intuition on this.
No.
You can use your intuition. Nobody's saying you can't use your intuition. But you also have to see what's in black and white.
Mm-hmm.
It's on the paper.
And what substantiates that, a lot of that, is the Sabian symbol. This is where the whole story of the Sabian symbol becomes remarkably accurate and even spooky to some extent, because of how it lines up and how accurate it becomes when you think about the symbolism that's there and how you approach the symbolism. So all symbols require an interpretive quality. They require us to interpret what that means. But it's not a far stretch with the Sabian symbols, because oftentimes they do make sense depending upon the aspect that's being triggered at that time, whether it be a Mars transit, whether it be a Saturn transit, whatever it may be. Usually it's an inner planet transit that will trigger an event that then maps up perfectly to the outcome of whatever happened, correct?
Yes, and the thing is that, again, as you said, it's very symbolic.
Yes.
So
it's open to interpretation. You've got to interpret it, yeah.
Right. Yeah, and you can't be carried away from that. You say, oh, this sounds perfect.
Mm-hmm.
All right, we've gone through this 100 times if we hadn't gone once. And we say, oh, that's so Venusian in a way, you know, like the way Venus like is so symmetrical in a way. And we say, well, this symbol fits perfectly. And you have to also be careful of that. You
right.
can't just go by the beauty of it all the time. You have to maintain a certain like kind of jaundiced eye towards it.
Right.
And say, okay, that looks really good, but let's look at a couple other symbols. Maybe there's more information there.
Right. And then once you get a couple of hits on it, when you get more than one hit on a symbol that's accurate, then you can drill down and say, yeah, this is more accurate. Because you need several, it's like anything in science, where you require empirical data. And the more empirical data you have that you gather around it, the more accurate your reading will become. It's really very critical. We're talking today with Mo Saladin, and he is an astrologer and an acupuncturist as well. But he's responsible behind the sabianearth.wordpress.com site, where they're doing chart rectifications of older people whose charts never may have been accurate in the past. And rectification is a sort of a subject that we're talking about. We're going to take a quick break here, and we'll be back in about 2 minutes. In the meantime, I encourage you to check out the website. It's sabianearth.wordpress.com. It's S-A-B-I-A-N, Earth, one long word, .wordpress.com. And we'll get back to you, Mo, in just a minute. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back in a few minutes. Hang in there.
What is your destiny? Where are you going? What is your real purpose? Do you know? Do you want to know? Of course you do. It's your duty to yourself. We are all here for a reason, and we all have great potential. Discover all of this and more with a professional astrology reading. My name is Chris Flisher, and I can help you. Discover your strengths and work on your weaknesses, and live your life to its fullest capacity. Based on your birthday, birthplace, and birth time, an authentic astrology reading will allow you to live your life to the fullest and reveal your true purpose. Only real astrology can give you real information. It is your destiny, and it is your path. Write me at chris@chrisflisher.com and book a reading today, or call me at 978-393-1036. That's 978-393-1036. www.chrisflisher.com.
Astrology is the science of spirit, and it can serve as an invaluable aid in making the difficult choices in life and seeking truth in all the directions we choose. It holds the potential to allow each of us to evolve to our highest potential. It is the logic of the universe, the code of existence, and the pathway to true wisdom. It is our duty to draw from it the instructions for our lives and to live them to our fullest potential. As the great wheel turns, we are best prepared when we are best informed.
As the world shrinks and our barriers come down, diverse cultures are striving for harmony, balance, and peace. To ease the transition, we need to expand with color, light, and tolerance. Now, you can become a global citizen and embrace the color and clear spirit with the divine artwork of the mandala. Mandalas are a timeless, artistic offering for creating unity, harmony, and peace. My name is Chris Flisher, and I've spent years creating mandalas, and they are now available online at www.turningofthewheel.com. Come and experience the world of color, form, and function with t-shirts, coffee mugs, note cards, and limited edition prints. These vibrant, lively paintings and products express optimism, oneness, and spiritual balance for all who use them. www.turningofthewheel.com. That's www.turningofthewheel.com. And enter a world of possibility and color.
Okay, welcome back to Turning of the Wheel. My name is Chris Flisher, and I'm the host of the show, and my guest today is Mo Saladin. He's a member of the Sabian Assembly, and the Sabian Assembly is an organization of astrologers and other metaphysicians who have followed the work of Marc Edmund Jones. Marc Edmund Jones is a historic character on the astrology stage, and he's probably in the astrology's greatest hits. He's one of the top ones because of his unique approach and how accurate he was, and the whole system he devised, working with astrology, working with metaphysics, working with psychic readers such as L.C. Wheeler. They devised this remarkable thing. And when you find these individual symbols, you've got to understand that these symbols, and when I refer to symbols, I refer to every degree of the zodiac. There's 360 degrees in the zodiac, 30 degrees per sign. In those 30 degrees, each degree has a symbol that's associated with it. So if you're born on one day and your symbol is Gemini 14, you would look up in the book for the interpretation of Gemini 14, and there'd be something in there that would resonate with you. And then you could also look at another, maybe you're ruling your more dominant planet. If you're dominated by Venus, you look up your Venus sign, your symbol. You look up your Mars symbol. You look up your Mercury symbol. And you begin to get a collection of data points that points to an incredibly accurate. And this was all done via a blind test, so to speak, because When Marc Edmund Jones devised these cards, he handed them to Elsie Wheeler face down, so she did not know the degree or the sign that was on the other side. She just looked at the thing, came up with an image that came through her through divine intervention, I think, and he copied down that symbol and described it and then went on to create an oracle, which is called the Sabian Oracle. And Mo Saladin has been working on rectifying some of Marc Edmund Jones's older charts to verify that these people truly are, because in some cases I'm sure the charts have changed as opposed to the way they were interpreted by Jones back in the day. Is that correct?
Of course they would change. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't say that whatever he said wasn't accurate based on the information that he had
at the time.
What happens is that the individual, when you have a chart that is more accurate, then everything kind of falls into place.
Yes.
I mean, if you're an actress or an actress and you, let's say like Marlon Brando or something like that, mm-hmm. when he went on stage and he had, you know, and all of a sudden he was recognized as this great actor, then you would be able to see that a little more accurately.
Yes.
And that's, you know, that just popped into my mind. But
yeah, and rectification really provides the missing link in some ways. It provides the precision we're looking for because, you know, I don't know about you, but for me as an astrologer who've been doing this for many years, I've still always remained skeptical of the information just because I think it's a safe way to approach things. I think it's always good to be somewhat doubtful, somewhat questioning what you're seeing. And so when you can get other aspects in there that sort of support your initial impression of a chart, it's very validating and it provides a great deal of proof and actually sort of it just verifies what you're seeing. That's why it's important.
Yeah, and there's other symbols too. Marc with Kent McClung did the Hyperion symbols, mm-hmm. Hyperion. And if you go to Sabian Earth, you will see that many times we use those symbols in place of the originals. All right. But Marc had a lot to do with those symbols. And, of course, Ken published the book under his own name. And that's another possibility that people can look at. They're a little bit more current, I would say, in
yeah.
terms of images. So if the symbol, you know, you can use those. I mean, people do that. And the other thing I should say, if anybody, like I said, if anybody wants their chart rectified, we can do that. But the other thing that we do is medical astrology.
Okay, yeah.
I mean, people come to our site, and if they have a problem and something can't be figured out, like diagnosis or whatever it is, we can look at the chart and give them information about, you know, what to look for.
Right, right.
And help their doctors or their acupuncturist or whoever it is and get a more accurate diagnosis based on astrology, which has been used for medical for many, many, you know, centuries.
So what do you think the greatest benefit of the rectified charts are, especially with characters that aren't as well known? When we look back at people who, like you mentioned, I think in our conversation, people who may not have been well known on the world stage, but were well known on the local stage. And you see that these aspects begin to play into place and they're lesser known characters on the stage, but still valid nonetheless. And yet we find the accuracy. What is the greatest value? Is that sort of a methodology for verifying astrology, proving astrology truly works? Do you think that's what its greatest gift is or greatest contribution?
Well, there has to be some kind of logical basis to the structure.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can't work outside. You can't just be willy-nilly about things.
Of course not.
I mean,
this is one science that requires precision. And I think of astrology as both a science and an art form. I think it's a little bit of both. Because the interpretation comes down to the art, I think.
Yeah, you can interpret it, but you want to have information that is able to give the client pointers or preferences to understand that they can make adjustments under certain crises.
Right.
I mean, we all go through different phases of our life, mm-hmm. if you want to look at it as a process-oriented approach, all right, which a lot of astrologers do. But you also have to have the ability to change course. When it's required for you to change course, instead of getting boxed in again.
Right. It's like knowing when to hold and when to fold, I always say, like, you know, the old gambler's routine. You know, you got to know that. And this is one of the real benefits of astrology, especially when you have precision involved. When you have the rectified chart, you are able to time events much more. And then you know, is it time to sort of push your artwork? Is it time to push your career? Is it time to have a baby, perhaps? Is it time to go back to school? Is it time to get married? These are major milestone events can provide great insight as to the timing, because timing really is what it's all about. Timing is where it is all about, because if you're there at the right place in time, marvelous things can happen, irregardless. Well, I shouldn't say irregardless, it's not a word. Regardless mm-hmm. of the... regardless of the, you know, where you are in your life and regardless of the timing. You may be going through a very difficult transit, but it could be actually a very beneficial one if it's used properly.
Yeah, and there's all kinds of ways of looking at, you know, transits, progressions, the natal chart, and like the mundane chart. Like we've been looking at the fall equinox chart, and we kind of looked at it in terms of the Democratic debates.
Yep.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I mean, so we said, okay, here it is. They just had a debate. The fall equinox is coming up. Let's look at that. And then the other thing we did was we did the eclipse for December.
Okay.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So we did those two charts in a mundane sense. And basically, the one for the fall basically said, Biden's holding his, you know, holding his position. Mm-hmm. You know, we got Saturn in the 10th house. You know, the old man, right?
Yeah.
I mean, here he is. It's in Capricorn. And if you read any information about the debate that just took place, everybody agrees. I mean, he might have lost some with people who watched the debate, but people who didn't watch the debate, you know, stayed pretty much on his side. So, and also people who are longtime blue to the core Democrats, all right? They don't like all the Johnny Come Early people who were on stage with him attacking him. Here's a guy that's been a blue Democrat for 50 years, right?
Yeah.
This guy has put in his time. He was vice president of the United States. And a lot of old timers who are Democrats are very upset about how people are approaching him, even though they know they have to win the election.
Well, right. I think the reluctance people, I mean, the reticence people have about him is sort of this falteringness and this sort of this showing of age. And that may be a personal quirk and not necessarily tied to his age, but it's easy to associate that. And, of course, people, the more they point that out, it becomes more of a topic. But you're right. He does have all the stuff he needs to do it. There's no question about it. A very accomplished man. But you know, I'm curious, why did you choose the equinox chart? Do you choose both equinoxes and both solstices for a bead on the country at the time in sort of that quadrant sort of fashion?
Yeah, we do the quadrant factor, you know, the next 3 months.
And what are the key things you look for in those quadrants? What are you looking at first?
Well, for instance, like the equinox chart has all the planets in the 10th house in Virgo.
Right.
Okay.
Yep.
And the eclipse chart has all the planets in Capricorn and up on top. There's six planets in Capricorn, including the moon.
Right.
So we're saying, okay,
highly charged.
Yeah.
We're
looking at different things.
All the emphasis that's in Capricorn, especially with Saturn and Pluto there currently, indicates a radical change of some sort. I mean, there has to be a change there.
In mundane, the 10th house is power. Mm-hmm. Keyword power.
And there's a certain amount of power that's being torn down. The Pluto-Saturn conjunction is about tearing down and rebuilding a new structure. So if someone like he were to come along, tear down what has been put out to us for the last 2 or 3 years, mm-hmm. and return to where we were, that would be a rebuilding, I would think. You know, the scandals have been exposed. The emperor has no clothes. We've seen all that, and now the time is to repair.
Well, we got Mars in the 8th house in that eclipse chart, and there could be an assassination attempt.
Interesting.
we're looking at. It could be Biden.
Yeah, I mean, when you say Mars,
I mean people. You know, people are really strange about this stuff.
People
have to realize there's a lot of things that go on behind it. That's why he pulled the Assange chart too. I mean, here's a guy that has support all the way across the, the spectrum, all the way from the left to the right. I mean, it's not just people who are liberal are against him or for him, or people who are conservative are for him or against him. He gets support all the way across.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's interesting from that point of view.
He becomes sort of apolitical. He's not a centrist, though.
Yeah, he's an anarchist. I don't know if you ever read anything about him read his papers and stuff, which I have. I mean, he's an idealist.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So he doesn't like all this stuff about working with Russia or taking, Snowden taking like information and whoever it is. He doesn't care about any government.
No,
he's against government.
Yeah, he's right.
He's an anarchist.
He's a purist.
I mean, people have to realize that. Yeah. He's like, he doesn't care what happens to Russia. He doesn't care what happens to the United States. He's just saying we shouldn't have, idealistically, what he thinks should be the way we should conduct our society.
Mm-hmm. And what did you find? Did you have to rectify his chart, or was his chart accurate?
Yeah, we rectified it. We look at everything, and pretty much every chart we're rectifying.
And when you're doing the rectification on these charts of old people whose maybe birth information is not clean, what are the key indicators that spark your acknowledgement that you're on the right track?
Well, usually, first of all, we have birth data information.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. So statistically, you're saying somebody says, okay, I was born at 5 a.m. All right. And for whatever reason, they know this, or whatever information we have that says that. All right.
Mm-hmm.
So when we get that, usually it's a very small window. It's like within 2 hours, okay,
right. Yep. Mm-hmm.
of that time.
Lock it up in that 2 hours. Yeah.
Right. So we've already eliminated 20 hours of the chart. I mean, there's some charts. I mean, we changed the Ginsburg chart. We had her at 1 degree of Cancer for her ascendant, and we changed it to 5 degrees of Virgo. Okay.
And that's because that's a big time gap.
That's 65 degrees.
Yeah.
64 degrees.
And is it accurate when you look at it now?
Yes, it's much more accurate. If people go to SaveMeOnEarth.com, it's much more accurate.
So what are the key indicators that you're looking at in her chart, her unrectified chart, that allow you to rectify? What are the pointers that you're seeking out? A progressed sun?
We're seeking out, okay, basically based on her events and basically what she has gone through,
mm-hmm.
that it fits into the wheel.
Okay.
That like, oh, you can't have this planet in the third house. It has to be in the first house. I mean, because you were affected that way. I mean, she has Mars in the first, we got Mars in the first house.
Yeah. I mean, she's a very Mars-oriented person because she's very feisty and has a real fighting spirit to her.
She's very feisty. And she's had a lot of problems with her health,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, things of that nature. So he said, hey, this is, you know, this is looking more like what, you know, there are certain indicators that always say that this is what is going on. Okay, mm-hmm. this fits this person.
But are you looking at inner planets or are you looking at outer planets?
The outer planets, of course, are, you know, according to Jones, are social significance.
Right.
I mean, they don't really, as an individual, they really don't fit in. They fit in more in mundane than they do in a natal chart.
Well, I would argue that they fit in, but only on a long-term basis. That's what you want to look at when you're looking at where they're... You want to look at the cycle, where she's going in that cycle, and where she would be, and where the long-term trends would be. But the inner planets do indicate more of the basic individual personality. I would agree with that, yeah. Personality traits.
She's lived a whole year in a cycle. You hit 84.
Yep.
Once you hit 84, it was like you had a Uranus return.
Uranus return, right? Obviously, very right. Critical point.
Yeah. So she's already gone through that. So listen, if you hit 84, right? You basically say, hey, I can say anything I want now.
Of course, because you've already done that full cycle, and it's either a boost that gives you a lift, or it's one that sort of brings you down.
And then the next one you would come to in terms of cycle would be Saturn at 90 years old, right?
Right.
28 to 30.
Yep.
58 to 60, 88 to 90.
Yep.
So Bill, in terms of what you're saying, yeah, you could look at those. I mean, they give you a longer view of things. They're not as specific. They're more general. But sometimes you want to see involvement and the evolvement of somebody.
Well, I think what it would do, it would be a second level of validation. You know, it may not be the primary, but it may be the secondary level of validation that certainly fits into the picture of her life at the time or whoever you're speaking of.
Yeah, well, we wanted to try to make this information available to astrologers, okay? Mm-hmm. It's not saying that we're right or we're wrong or anything like that, okay? You have a lot of charts. People aren't doing charts, okay? They want to go to a site. They want to put up a chart if they're interested in somebody. And, we were talking about the lead singer for the Cars. He just passed away.
Right.
Right? Yeah, we put up Rick Ocasek's information, all right, and stuff like that. So people are interested.
Of course they are. Of course they are. And what did you have to rectify his chart, or did you find it accurate?
No, we just put up, we were devastated. I mean, the Cars are one of the great groups of all time.
Yeah.
I mean, we're talking legendary here. I mean, and the person that I wanted to say is one of the persons that got a lot of hits, all right, over the course of the last couple of years was Donna Cunningham, the astrologer, because nobody did her chart.
Right.
Nobody did it. Nobody said anything about it. And it would just keep on coming back. People really loved the gal.
I know. I had her on as guest. I had her on as a guest many times. Yeah.
And there was nothing done, and nobody wrote anything. We got so many, like, thank yous from people. Because we don't get any money. Okay, we have a PayPal account. You could send us money, just like to you. Please, send money to Chris.
Yeah, really. I mean,
come on, people. We're out here. We're trying to work. We're trying to open these things up to you. You might not agree with us, but that's not the point. The point is that we really care about it, but we would really appreciate that also.
Well, you know what it does? As I have always said, I know it sounds cliche, but it does keep the wheel turning. I mean, that's the name of my show, is Turning of the Wheel, and it does keep the wheel turning. Mm-hmm. Without that cha-ching in there, it doesn't work. And we do this work out of labor of love. I mean, I interviewed you, mentioned Donna. I've been doing this for 13 years. You mentioned Donna Cunningham. I interviewed her probably four or five times over the course of my time on the radio.
She was wonderful, wasn't she?
And she was amazing, a wonderful guest. And her shows are all on my archives on my website, turningofthewheel.com or chrisflisher.com. You simply go to the media drop-down, and there's radio archives, and you go back through the years, and they're all there, and you can find the shows I did with Donna Cunningham, and you'll see how remarkable it was. And she was a what did you find out about her? That did you rectify her chart as well?
Yes, we did. Mm-hmm. We did.
Now, people and within the world of astrology, she was actually a very major, big, a very large character, because she was incredible.
She was a huge character, over the years. I mean, she was available to everybody.
Always.
I mean, it was just amazing.
Yeah, she never said no to me.
I pull up the chart. I can't remember anything unless I pull the chart up again.
No, I'm the same way. It's impossible.
I must know where Chris's ascendant is.
You can't. There's just too much information. I'm pretty good with remembering people's sun sign, but I can't always remember all the other details. It's just too much. I mean, I do in my close family and my close friends, but overall, it's just too much data to cram into our heads.
Right, and there's certain people that you would, like your family or close friends or something.
Yeah, of course.
You might click with you because you look at your chart, and then you look at their chart and say, oh, wow, we have this connection here.
Yeah, of course.
And that's you would do that.
One of the beautiful things. But I think the work of Edmund Jones was that he allowed us to introduce a whole new interpretive method to this, which you have to admit, it really is supernatural when you think about the way this whole story went down. I mean, this, you know, Elsie Jones was a crippled woman, but had incredible psychic powers. Marc Edmund Jones at the time was a Presbyterian minister. Now, you would never associate any traditional Protestant religion with astrology, but Presbyterianism does have a sense, does pay homage to predestiny. So at least that part is there, which would then account for Jones's fascination with astrology. And then when he starts doing the charts and finds the accuracy of what's going on there, it's impossible not to be compelled to that. But then when you find this woman who brings along this symbolic quality and these stories, these images that come in, and it's just incredible. And the reason, by the way, that you go up 1 degree from your sun sign is because you want to always want to round up, because oftentimes people are born at, like I'm born at 12 degrees 5 minutes. I'm going to bump myself up to 13 degrees. That's pretty much the rule for all of the Sabian symbols. And so you would do that. And there's many good books out there about the Sabian symbols and Marc Edmund Jones. And as Mo was mentioned, all of his books are available. And I encourage you to do this, because these are books that are out of print now. They are old-fashioned. They are tight. The way their typeface is a little bit unusual. But the information is there. The data is there. It's a fascinating discovery for those of you who are really intrigued by astrology and the accuracy of the symbolism and what it pretends. It does make you really scratch your head and say, gosh, there's got to be some logic. Somebody's in charge here, because this is just too accurate.
Yes, and you could, and if you get a hold of us, we can give you the information to go to the person. They're all hardcover books.
Yeah.
The AFA used to store them.
And these are these are limited edition books, folks. You're not going to find these on. You're not going to find these at Barnes and Noble. You're not going to find them on Amazon. You've got to search these out, but they are incredibly valuable, especially for students of astrology who really want to know another method of how to interpret. This adds a whole new dimension to how a chart is interpreted. It brings a whole new flavor in. It brings a story, a narrative, because astrology really is a collection of stories. You know, how does your Mercury get along with Mars, and how does your Moon get along with Venus? These are stories, and when you tease the stories out, then you get the accuracy of the person, because we are all I believe that we are a part of a great long continuum, and the stories are being told again and again and again, just at a different place in time. That's my logic.
Yeah, and I, you know, like I do like for the month, I always do the mental chemistry, which is the Moon's fast or slow, or Mercury is ahead or behind the Sun, right. So I just think for everybody right now, transiting wise, we're in a slow moon, and you know, it's cautious and tentative. It's a tentative moon, and Mercury is behind. Mercury's behind, and Moon is slow.
So when Mercury's behind, things are not quite as spontaneous. Things are not quite as quick.
No.
The conversation.
Well, Marc calls it the Gestalt thing. I'm slow mental chemistry. What do you call slow? There's slow mental chemistry, fast mental chemistry, which the Moon would be, you know, fast, and Mercury is ahead. So you get the sharp, eager minds. You know, people can make decisions real quick, as opposed to the Gestalt mind. And the other two are equal, because they're normal based on the fact that one's slow and the other, you know, the Moon. Mercury is behind, you know, fast.
And even as we're speaking today, we've got the Moon at 4 degrees Taurus, and Uranus is at 6 degrees Taurus. So there, you know, that the combination of those two could bring about sort of a startling revelation, which is really remarkable in itself.
So you won't be able to make a real quick decision based on the transits.
Right.
You would tend to miss some opportunities at this point.
Right. Absolutely.
And that's just the way it is, because you're going to think, oh, maybe I should do this. Maybe I should do that. Before you know it, you missed the bus.
Well, what did you find out about Rick Ocasek, by the way, while we're talking about him? What did you find when you did his chart? What was the thing that jumped out at you?
Well, it just came. She just put it up this morning.
Okay.
I read just the information. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I can't remember how many, one of my friends called me on it, because he was a big fan of the cars, huge fan, and he was devastated.
Yeah,
I mean, he was playing the music. Mm-hmm. So I I said, wow. So I had to go and put on some music.
Yeah.
I put on a couple of tunes from the Cars.
Right.
And it was great.
And it seems as if he had a very peaceful ending, it sounded like. And it sounded like he came with recovering from surgery and he was home with his family and just sort of drifted off in the way we all would love to go. None of us want to go through the hardship. We want to go through the easy exit if we can.
No, you don't want to be like George Patton.
No, you don't want to be crippled or even someone like ALS. Who does that? Now, and there's plenty of people. And Jones really delved into a wide range of people over the course of his life. He would not stick with anyone. He'd do politicians. He'd do artists. He'd do musicians. He'd do statesmen, generals. Poets. Yeah. He did a wide array of people.
This guy, he was a jockey. I never heard of him. And he won like Ascot, I don't know how many times. The Derby, right?
Yeah,
the famous English Derby. I'm saying, like, this guy was fabulous.
Strong Mars in his chart, I imagine.
And that's how, people have to realize that, hey, it's just more it's kind of an educational site in that sense. You can read things, like I said, you might not agree, but at least you're getting more and more perception and understanding as you go through page by page. If you're interested, you might only be interested in one person.
Right. But like any scientific discovery or any scientific pursuit, the more empirical data that you can gather, obviously the closer you're going to get to the truth. And of course, I think that's part of the joy of astrology, because as time moves on, we're gathering more and more empirical data every minute. And of course, we're more cognizant of birth time and birth place. We have much more of a mechanized world now, where the precision of degrees are there. We have a precision with time. We have people who are recording things with their phones, and so there's a timestamp involved. So, astrology really is, as time goes on, becoming more and more accurate. So we've run out of time, Mo, but I do encourage people to get to your site, sabianearth.wordpress.com. No, it's S-A-B-I-A-N, earth.wordpress.com. And on there you'll find it's a research site, but it's got incredible interesting, especially for students of astrology who want to know how to rectify a chart, or what a rectified chart looks like, or even for somebody who is curious about a very famous person who may not be well known. The odds are that they may be there are lesser known. There's a certain tier to fame. Maybe you're a person that lives on through the centuries. Maybe you're a person that lives on through the decade. Who knows? But there's a wide array in between. But I encourage you to go there. Again, my guest has been Mo Saladin, and he's behind sabianearth.wordpress.com, which deals with the rectification of charts and the work of Marc Edmund Jones, who founded the Sabian Assembly, and in itself is a fascinating subject in and of itself. It's just, and there's no question about it. Marc Edmund Jones is someone to really pursue if you're at all interested in astrology. So, Mo, thank you very much for coming on today and talking with us about
this. Thank you. Yeah, anybody that wants to contact us, please do.
Yeah.
We'd really help you in any way we can.
Yeah, there you go.
Thank you, Chris.
Yeah, you're very welcome. Yeah, great.
You've been listening to Turning of the Wheel with your host, Chris Flisher. To schedule a reading with me or to order artwork, you may visit my website at www.turningofthewheel.com. That's www.turningofthewheel.com. Or you can call me at 978-393-1036. Thank you. And as always, be open to possibilities.